Thanks a lot for the introduction. As Valentina said, I will talk about a biologically inspired model which we use in order to reproduce generate Poggendorf type illusions, and it's a joint work with Luca, Valentina, and Dario. Before I start, I would like to give a brief outline of the whole talk. First, I will provide some general information about cortical modeling and about the notion of subromanian geometry. Which actually have been explained in quite some detail by previous speakers. And in the second part, I will present a cortically inspired model for Poggendorf type illusions. And finally, I will quickly wrap up by mentioning our future plans and in which phase we are in terms of research regarding this work, regarding the continuation of this work, which we will see. Okay. Primary visual cortex is the main part of the brain, which is responsible for the first step processing of visual input, which we collect from nature, in order that we perform proper visual perception. And this part of the brain contains a specific family of neurons, which we call simple cells. The particularity of simple cells is that those cells are sensitive to, they can extract the information related to, several visual features, such as orientation, frequency, phase, color, and so on. And in fact, right now, thanks to their orientation selectivity, sensitivity, we're able to distinguish between the different angles of the rotating bar on the screen. So how do those cells achieve extracting the information related to those visual features? Well, by using their so-called receptive profiles. So what's a receptive profile? It's basically the impulse response function of a simple cell. So once we're exposed to some visual input, the neurons on the retinal layer produce some spikes, which are transmitted through specific pathways to the primary visual cortex, to the simple cells in the primary visual cortex. And each simple cell produces, gives a response to those spikes. And these are what we call receptive profiles, the impulse response functions of these simple cells. And mathematically, we can model the receptive profiles by using Gabo functions. One of the key features of Gabo functions, and which is particularly important for us, is that any Gabo function, say a generic Gabo function, psi, which is sensitive to the visual stimulus located at the point with the compounds x and y on the two-dimensional image plane, and which is sensitive to the objects, to the stimulus, which is in alignment with the direction corresponding to the orientation angle theta, can be obtained from a reference function psi zero, which we call Gabor model function, and which can be expressed as Noemi showed more explicitly in terms of a localizing Gaussian window and the wave content. And the relation between these generic expression of a Gabor function and the Gabor model function is formed through the following coordinate transform, which is represented by capital A, and which basically says that, well, take your Gabor model function psi zero, which is presumably located at the origin of the two-dimensional image plane, M, which is two-dimensional Euclidean plane, and translate it to the point with the compounds x and y, and rotate at that point your translated Gabor model function by the orientation angle theta. And there you will find your Gabor function, your receptive profile, corresponding to the simple cell, which is sensitive to the stimulus located at the point with the compounds x and y, and which is sensitive to the stimulus which is in alignment with the direction corresponding to the orientation angle theta. Well, at every point on the two-dimensional image plane. Well, by the way, I mean we assume that image plane and retinal plane and cortical layer they're identical, so we ignore those retinal cortical mappings. So at each point on image plane, we find those column-like structures which we call orientation fibers. And orientation fiber contains the Gabor functions or the receptive profiles, which are rotated by all possible orientation angles. And the collection of all these orientation fibers comprises up to what we call the set of receptive profiles. In short, the set of receptive profiles is the set of receptive profiles shortly contains the receptive profiles, Gabor functions, corresponding to all possible combinations of translations and rotations. And this set of receptive profiles is associated with the well-known hypocomnal architecture of the primary visual cortex, the architecture which was discovered and reported by Hubel and Wiesel in their Nobel Prize work. And this hypocomnal architecture was proposed to be modeled by Hoffman in terms of a contact bundle structure. Later on, by Jean Petitot and Yannick Tondou, this idea was improved further. And in this contact bundle structure, they provided a boundary completion approach. Moreover, they provided a geometric interpretation of the association fields, which were reported by Field, Hess, and Hayes as the psychophysical representations of the neural connections, which are biologically implemented in the primary visual cortex. And this construction, this framework, which was provided by Petit and Tondou, was developed further later on by Chit and Sarti, where they introduced a group-based approach, and where they proposed to model this hypocomnal architecture and the functional connectivity within by using the sub-Riemannian geometry of the group of rotations and translations, or shortly SP2. And we use the geometric framework, which was provided in this last work rather, as the geometric setting in which we propose our algorithms generating Poggendorf type illusions. So let me say a few more words about this geometrical setting and its relation to receptive profiles. So to each one of those receptive profiles in the set of receptive profiles, we can assign the following one form, which is represented by lambda, and which depends on the orientation angle parameter theta. This form is particularly important because it's the main mathematical instrument which models the orientation selectivity of the simple cells, since it gives its maximum response, which is the unit response, once its orientation angle parameter theta coincides with the direction of the vector field x3. So what's the particularity of this vector field x3? Well, it's the vector field which is in the direction of the maximum gradient direction of the receptive profiles of the Gabor functions. In other words, Gabor functions, just like the one from lambda, give their maximum responses once the maximum gradient direction coincides with the actual gradient direction of the two-dimensional image, of the objects in the two-dimensional image, just like in this example, just like in the case of this example disk image. And in this way, Gabor functions can extract the boundaries of the objects found in the given two-dimensional image. Okay, and this one form relates the receptive profiles to the sub-Riemannian geometry of SA2 because it naturally directly induces the horizontal tangent space corresponding to the sub-Riemannian geometry of SA2. Since by definition, horizontal tangent space is the kernel of the one form lambda, in other words, it's the span of two horizontal vector fields, x1, as we saw previously in talks of previous speakers, the vector field in the tangent direction to the objects in the given two-dimensional image, and x2 is the vector field in the direction of in the orientation dimension in the three-dimensional geometry. And horizontal tangent space can be thought of as the analogy of the Euclidean tangent space. In other words, in this particular geometry, we define any differential operator, say a sub-Riemannian Laplacian, sub-Riemannian gradient, sub-Riemannian curvature, and so on, by using only these two horizontal vector fields. And it allows, I mean, the geometry itself is three-dimensional, but we define all differential operators in terms of those two horizontal vector fields. And this allows us to exploit, take advantage of the high anisotropy of the geometry, where we find a good representation of the extracted visual information, which in this case is the orientation information corresponding to the given two-dimensional image. And why do we consider this geometry as a good model of the hypocomnal architecture and the functional connectivity within related to the primary visual cortex? Because it provides a good model of the neural connectivity. in the sense that the projection of the horizontal integral curves, those are the integral curves along the horizontal vector fields x1 and x2, and the projection of those integral curves, those horizontal integral curves, onto the two-dimensional image plane, as we see on the right-hand side, overlap, coincide closely. They are good approximations of the actual association curves, as I mentioned a couple of slides ago, which were reported by Fields, Hess, and Hayes, and which we can consider as the psychophysical representations of the actual neural connections within the primary visual cortex. Okay, so having in hand this geometric setting, now we would like to provide an evolution procedure for the evolving neural activity in order to generate Poggendorf-type illusions. So first, let me say briefly what we mean when we say Poggendorf illusions. When we say Poggendorf illusions, we refer to the misperception of two parallel transversal oblique, which are interrupted by a blocking bar. And an example of such illusions can be seen in this illustration here. For example, here we see the black and blue lines as if they were continuations of each other. However, the real case is actually not. I mean, actually, the red and black curves, black lines are the continuations of each other, not the blue and black ones. And this misalignment in our perception, visual perception, is what we call Poggendorf illusions. And these kind of illusions can be induced by test images such as sinusoidal gratings, which are interrupted again by a blocking bar in the middle region, and where the Poggendorf illusions are induced. I mean, in the middle region. And our aim is to reproduce those Poggendorf illusions by using such test images. Well, this problem was studied by Hoffman, Smith, and later on by Ahmed Wackerman from different points of views. And more recently, and more important to our case, by Francescello Mastakovci Tensarti, those illusory patterns were proposed to be modeled as the geodesics in the subromanian geometry of SE2. And later on, by Bertagno Calatrone Franceschi, Francesca Lamprandi, two algorithms, which they named as three-dimensional Wilson-Cobham and three-dimensional locally circumequalization algorithms, in the subromanian geometry of SE2, again, the same subromanian geometry, were proposed in order to generate those Poggendorf illusions. And for us, these two algorithmic procedures provide the departure point of our study. So I will try to explain those two algorithms, and then I will show in which way we contribute and provide our novel algorithms, starting from those two. So both of those algorithms are based on three steps, where the first step is what we call the lifting. And the lifting procedure provides the output responses of the simple cells, of the simple cell receptive profiles, to a given image, which is represented by capital I, which can be thought of as this two-dimensional image with circles with different red I. And it's obtained via the convolution of the given two-dimensional image I with the rotating filter banks of the receptive profiles. At the end, we end up with the lifted version of the two-dimensional image, which provides a good representation of the orientation information within the two-dimensional image, but now represented in the three-dimensional subromanian geometry of SE2. Once we obtain those output responses of the simple cells via lifting, the idea, which was proposed in Bertagno et al., was to model the neural activity evolution starting from those output responses by using a Wilson-Cobham type equation system, where the lowercase a represents the evolving neural activity corresponding to the neuron located at the point xi in the subromanian geometry SE2. Here xi is just a shorthand notation of x, y, and theta. And where lambda is a parameter, is a constant, and where calligraphic I and calligraphic U represent the neural interaction term and the external stimulus. Here we see that the external stimulus consists of two parts, where the first part is a weighted version of the initial output responses, the result of the lifting. And the second part, tilde O, is the lifting of a blurred version, a smoothed version of the input image. And the reason for that this second part was included was the will to take into account the contrast effects of the pixels surrounding the region which we focus on when we look at a two-dimensional image. I mean, when we focus on a region which is surrounded by rather bright pixels, we perceive the region which we focus on as brighter than actually it is. And if the pixels surrounding this region are darker, then we perceive as darker than actually it is. And this effect, this contrast effect of the surrounding pixels, were taken into account via this second term, tilde O. And the neural interactions were modeled as the convolution, three-dimensional convolution, of the firing activity function sigma, which is a piecewise linear function, and which takes as input the relative neural activity with respect to the average gray value. With a neural interactivity term, where the neural interactivity kernel W. And one thing which is important to be mentioned is that in this setting of Bertalmy et al., this kernel was chosen to be a three-dimensional Gaussian. However, three-dimensional Gaussian cannot capture the anisotropic structure of the subromanian geometry. In other words, it's not really compatible. It's not a compatible operator with the subromanian geometry of SP2. And this is actually the point where we contribute. We will see that we replace this neural interaction term, this convolution, with a more compatible numerical procedure, but more compatible with the subromanian geometry of SV2. Okay, at the end of the evolution, the third step is back projection. So it's basically at the end of the evolution of neural activity, projecting back the image by integrating over the orientation fibers the evolved neural activities, and to come back to the two-dimensional image plane, where the goal is to see well produced Poggendorf type illusions. This algorithm was named as three-dimensional Wiesenkauen, and the second algorithm, three-dimensional local isogramicalization, was following quite a similar approach. However, the only difference is that now the input of the firing activity is not any longer the relative activity and relative neural activity with respect to the average gray, but it's rather the differences, localized differences of the neural activities, evolving neural activities. This small change had important consequences, as Bertalmy and Casseyes, Porovens and Rizzi showed in 2007. They showed that once this change is done in the formulation of this system, this system could be written as an energy minimization problem, where the solutions minimizing the energy were providing the patterns along which the neural activity propagation was taking place. And this was in coherence with the efficient representation principle, which basically says that, okay, neural responses are self-adaptive in such a way that they minimize the redundant statistical information extracted from a two-dimensional image. In other words, they provide the most efficient representation of the visual information extracted from the image by spending the less amount of sources. And back projection, again, is exactly the same as before. And this algorithm was called three-dimensional local histogram equalization. So what we propose is,
sorry, let me stop you. Just to say that we have four more minutes, just so that you can organize your...
Okay, no problem, thanks. Okay, and what we propose is that the lifting is exactly the same, but the second step... In the second step, we replaced the neural interaction term, calligraphic I, which was modeled as the convolution uh, the previous setting of Bertalmy et al. With a subramanian heat diffusion iterative procedure, where L is the heat subramanian heat diffusion operator, which is expressed in terms of the horizontal vector fields x1 and x2, and a coefficient beta, which guarantees the unit coherency. And thanks to this operator, we are able to restrict the diffusion to be along the horizontal integrated curves, which are the models in the models of the neural connections within the subramanian geometry. What we do is at the end of each step of the Wilson-Cohen type neural activity evolution equations, we perform another iterative procedure, the subramanian heat diffusion equation, and feed the result of this procedure into the Wilson-Cohen type equations as the neural interaction term. And we repeat this procedure at each step of Wilson-Cohen type equations. And we call, well, at the end, back projection is again the same. We call this system the subramanian Wilson-Cohen, subramanian because now this second procedure is more compatible with the subramanian geometry. And in a similar way, we apply the same idea to the second algorithm, which was proposed in the previous setting of Bertalmy et al. And we end up with a subramanian local histogram equalization algorithm. Okay, very quickly, I will show some results and then finish the talk. On the left column, we see the results of the previous setting of Bertalmy et al., both Wilson-Cohen and local histogram equalization. On the right column, our setting, and we see that in the Wilson-Cohen case, our algorithm can produce the illusions, albeit their low quality. However, in the previous setting, they cannot be produced at all. In the local histogram equalization, both settings can produce the illusions, but our framework can preserve, in addition to producing the illusions, it can preserve the rest of the image. Okay, that's open access work recently published. So if you want, if you're interested in, you can go to the website of Journal of Imaging and have a look. So let me finish the talk by mentioning the future work. Okay, we would like to study also other illusions, in particular tilt illusions. We would like to also study the spatial frequency effects on this Poggendorf type and also on tilt illusions. And we are actually in the phase of performing studying bifurcation analysis on these algorithms in order to see that which parameter region produces illusory patterns and which parameter regions not. Okay, I think that's all from my side. Thank you. I hope I'm in touch.